My name is Jens Hoffmann. I'm the Deputy Director for Public Programs and Exhibitions here at the Jewish Museum. And I'd like to welcome you. I'm very excited to see so many people here tonight, despite the bitter cold. I barely made it here myself. As you can tell, I'm a little bit under the weather, had a cold and a flu for the last couple of days. But this warmed me up, the prospect of coming here to the panel today. And this is the third one in a series of conversations that we've had about contemporary painting that I conceived together with Jordan Kantor. Jordan is an artist and professor at the California College of the Arts. We've collaborated on a number of projects, and when I set out thinking about a program that we could create alongside our Marc Chagall exhibition and also the exhibition of Mel Bohner, this is coming up, I couldn't think of a better partner than Jordan, who to me is probably one of the most knowledgeable persons when it comes to the subject of painting. So I was very excited when Jordan agreed to work with us on this particular program. And tonight is our final panel, and Jordan is going to introduce all the different speakers, and I'm looking forward to a good evening here. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, thank you, Jens, and thank you, everybody, for showing up. This is so exciting for me to have an audience here and to have the audience, most importantly, of these important artists. And I'm humbled that you all said yes and are taking time from your painting schedule and all the projects that you're working towards to spend the evening with us and tell us a little bit about what you're up to. Like Jens said, we developed this series of three programs as a means to put a spotlight on contemporary painting and to give the platform to a number of contemporary artists whom we admire, who represent extremely different positions, to talk a little bit about their own practice. This is not an exercise in trying to build the connections between these artists and to say that this is part of something that's going on or that there might be anything that would particularly bind their practices together, but rather instead to pick a diverse group of artists who have really set out important individuated positions and who are here only to speak about their own position and about their own interests. And so we're lucky that they've all agreed to do this, and I'm especially gratified. So what I'm hoping is that I've asked each of them to bring a couple of images, one an image of a recent work that they've made, either something that's finished or something that's in process or something that they're wondering whether it's done or not, and then to bring a second work, which either is a work of art or just an image of something that would be interesting also that represents their interests that are happening outside the canvas and outside the frame. And the hope is that maybe we could talk a little bit thereafter, after each of them show us these two images, about the relationship between their work and their other interests, and maybe just have a little bit of shop talk in your presence. And the idea is we'll do five short presentations, then we're gonna have a conversation amongst, they will have it amongst themselves, and when there are lulls or proddings or I have a question, I will interject and move the conversation along. And then as the third part comes to an end, we can open the floor. These guys have graciously offered to entertain questions from the audience, and so we'll maybe have 15 minutes or 20 minutes for that at the end. I'm imagining this will be no longer than an hour and a half, and I think we are incredibly lucky and grateful to have everybody here. So thank you for coming, and thank you to these folks, and thank you all. One last footnote I'll say is that this program was advertised to have six artists, and unfortunately, Dash, who was going to participate, woke up ill this morning and was feeling horrible that she couldn't come, and we were trying to represent her position anyway, and it just didn't work out. So in absentia, she is here in spirit, and maybe we can catch her with the program some next time. So these are the five that we have, and we're incredibly lucky, and will you kick it off?
Happy to.
Okay, so let me just say first, I'll give a little intro of each of our participants, which is just about the projects that they're working on now and upcoming. So this is Tip Dunham, who we're lucky to have in the city before he escapes later this evening to go back to grind on some new paintings out in the country that will, I guess, be seen in Zurich next in June in a show that he will have at Eva Pressenhuber's gallery. He's also an artist who is very close to my heart for his writing practice, which in addition to his painting practice is extremely evocative and clear. And he wrote a memorable piece on late Renoir that appeared in Art Forum maybe a year or two ago. And his painting practice has been inspiring for a long time. And I clearly remember the show at the New Museum maybe in 95 or something that rocked my world, and I'm still sort of thinking about that. So we're looking forward to hearing from Tip. So why don't you take that along, and then you can do your presentation, and then I'll introduce Jacqueline when right before we get to her painting. So the floor is yours. Here's the remote.
So you go like so.
Try it. There you go.
Can I use your mic?
Please.
Thank you. For the last about 4 years, the subject matter in my work has been pretty much the same, which is images of women and images of nature, focusing mostly on this kind of reductive vocabulary I've made up of, or that evolved in my work, of trees and flowers. And it's not in any sense a representation of nature, and I don't work from life, so the paintings are really constructions that come about really through drawing and the way drawing mixes with my imagination as I'm working. This is an image of the last painting I finished. In the last year or so, I started to develop these, you know, I come from a place of originally wanting to make abstract painting, and the subject matter came into my work almost through the back door. So in order for me to be able to draw things, I have to be able to paint them. I have to sort of be able to imagine how to draw them. And I've started a series of drawings that has led to this group of paintings of the image centers around a woman diving into the water, deeper into the space of the painting. And this is the first large painting in that group that I finished. I've been getting more and more involved with I think of it as a kind of weird rigidity, like a geometry in the way that I draw, finding correspondences and relationships that allow me to build the image almost like an armature. And you can see there are a lot of, like everything starts from the image of the woman. In this case, her right foot is tangent to the right side of the painting, and it really starts by drawing five little rings over the ends of toes, and then from there everything kind of builds and has to become a drawing before it can really be a painting. I can't really speak to the content of all this in such a short presentation. The subjects I told you about, the materiality is very specific, as with all paintings. That's one of the things we like about it. I work with a variant of acrylic paint in very thin layers, so you wouldn't really see a surface. You'd see an image, and you see a lot of, it's very clear they're hand-painted, but there's no physical build-up. So I'm very drawn right now at this point in my work to this notion that the strongest reality of the painting is optical, but that you always know you're looking at something that's handmade. The other image is a painting called Ranchers of the Panhandle Fighting Prairie Fire with Skinned Steer by an artist called Frank Michaud. And it's from the cover of a book I've been studying called The Texas Post Office Murals. I don't remember how this material first came to my attention. I was trying to remember today, and I just can't. But if you Google Texas Post Office murals, you'll see that the state of Texas is well aware that they have something interesting on their hands. There's a whole website devoted to these things. The WPA was very active in Texas, and there are over 100 of these murals spread around the state of Texas, many of which you can still see. I've only seen one in person. I was in Texas this year, and I had this idea to try to see more, but the distances are so vast that I overestimated my abilities. So I'm planning another trip to go. to see them. I think the interest comes from, I'm always looking for things that surprise me, make me think, that sort of challenge what I think is maybe the most basic truths about my own work. One of the things that I've always said about my work is that narrative has nothing to do with it, and that it's still fundamentally an abstract idea about painting. So WPA murals are sort of the exact opposite of that. They're completely driven by subject matter. They have a social function, which is very different from the way that the painting done by people on this panel operates socially, certainly. And all of that's really interesting to me. And also, I rather like the idea that you could go to a place in the middle of the United States and visit a painting. It's like when I was younger and I made my trips to Italy to find things, and you go to some little village somewhere and there's a masterpiece sitting in a little building. Not to claim that these are the same level of thing, but there's something very nice about it all. So.
Great, thank you. All right, this is gonna be good. So Jacqueline Humphries is sitting to our right, and her work is, we'll see some paintings, but it's often quite notoriously difficult to photograph, I think. And I think this is maybe, without laying an interpretation on what you do, part of what you're up to, which is about how we are seeing the paintings and our relationship to being in front of them and moving around them. And I don't know if that's part of your intentionality, but it's something that I find very exciting about seeing your work. So we're looking forward to seeing more of your paintings here in New York next at the Whitney Biennial, which will open in whenever it opens in March. And then after that, a solo show Jacqueline is working towards in May that will be seen at the Modern Art Gallery in London. And hopefully, if all goes well, in 2015 back here at Green Naftali for a solo show with Carroll. So that's what's on the agenda, and let's see some paintings. You want to run this, or should I? Let's keep passing that down. It might be all best. Right. Just go that arrow twice.
Twice?
Yeah, there you go.
Thank you, Jordan. I actually put two images of my own, not to be greedy, but because I don't know that either of these paintings are finished, but I decided to show a couple of things that are in my studio right now, just because that's what I'm interested in looking at and thinking about, and they bear a lot of resemblance with things I've made in the last few years. But this painting is about 8 feet. It's almost square. It's a little wider than a square. And for those of you who don't know, I know a lot of you do know, but a feature of my work the last several years has been the silver paint I've been using. And that's why they're hard to photograph, because they really change a lot with the light. But at the moment, I've been mining. I feel like I'm sort of mining a seam, and I keep kind of making the same painting over and over. And it's characterized just by having this frame in it. And that's about as far as it goes right now for me, as far as drawing is concerned. And I mention that just because I think it's so interesting that tip always starts with a drawing. And I feel like my work is really the tradition of American painting that I'm interested in most. I feel has mostly to do with mass. And it works against a more European tradition, which favors drawing, you know, which gives primacy to what's known by historians as disegno. And I just start by sort of drawing the thing that I'm painting on, this rectangle, sort of to restate the object. And then I just kind of go forward. And this painting was made in one session, and it's just about filling it up, really. In the case of this, like the marks inside of the frame are a little bit denser and indifferent than what lies outside, but it's almost impossible. It's almost an impression that kind of comes and goes, like you see it and then you don't, and it seems to form this kind of pattern, and it's just sort of the pattern of making that only certain things are possible, or I have like a certain retinue of moves that I'm using and tools. I'm using maybe four different kinds of objects to get the paint on there, from sponges to brushes to, big scrapers, and I just sort of mix it up, and it's hours and hours of just sort of not stopping and creating a sort of rhythm, very much like Pollock did when he painted, sort of creating a rhythm of making and sort of like knowing what I'm doing but not really knowing what I'm making, and I also make them kind of backwards, like the everything that's black goes on first and silver goes on top, and then I kind of scrape the whole thing down. It's almost like this painting appears, you know, but it's sort of like you're looking at it from behind. And I think that's why I've said to others, and I think of what I do almost more as sculpture. Like I'm trying to see it from the front and the back at the same time, and there's something about this flat sculpture. I feel like I'm trying to make a flat sculpture. I don't know what that means exactly. It's just this impression I had. And I also wanted to give two secondary images, but I couldn't decide which one, so I just put them together. And what you're looking at is a Cézanne painting of nudes and a still from Orson Welles' Lady of Shanghai. And Cézanne, like when I was a teenager, I saw a big Cézanne show in Houston of the late work, and it was really the first real painting I'd seen, you know, in depth, and it made a really big impression on me. And after making this, I feel like, oh, this actually looks like the paintings I'm making right now in some funny way, like the way that sort of the frame drawing and the marks that sort of are very heterogeneous to it kind of get smashed into one surface. But the thing is, I don't really think about painting that much. I think about other things like film, and I'm very into like noir cinema and like everything, you know, like to do with screen culture, like Woody Allen. I think about him more than I think about painters, maybe like people who sort of like the thing I love about Woody Allen is like he was a stand-up comedian, but he loved Bergman, you know, and like how is he going to get from where he was to Bergman, and he really does manage to do it. Like it's all this paradoxical thing in his films. Like they're comedies, but you come away thinking about pretty serious things. You might even be like downright depressed. But anyway, I was surprised how like these two images sort of seem to really work together. This kind of all over color field painting, essentially, with this black and white noir image. So anyway, you can ask me any questions you want about it. And I'll pass it back to you.
Fantastic, Jordan. Thank you. Well, this is we're lucky that the limitations created this image.
The limit. Oh.
Yeah, great. Thank you for putting that together. I love that. All right, so we're going to double back to all of this later, but I want to move on to Sanya Kantarovsky, who, oh, by the way, these tables are not split because we're Camp A and they're Camp B. This is to keep our shadows off the image, so we're all one group and we're friends. Sanya just got back from Germany, where he was installing work in a group show at the Badischer Kunstverein, and he's also participating in a group show at White Flag Projects in St. Louis. I most recently saw a full collection of his work out in San Francisco, where I live, at Claudia Altman Siegel's gallery several shows ago, and he's preparing for, I think, will it be his first show at Casey Kaplan, which will be a solo show of paintings and other things set to open in May. So thank you for coming and for sending us these images.
Thank you for inviting me. It's very surreal, obviously, for me to be here, especially the other person who is young and immature and sick. So I'll do my best to represent my aimless generation. For me, I grew up in Moscow and moved here when I was 10. And in the last few years, I've been coming back to a lot of the images and painted images that I grew up with that are kind of totally outside of a kind of Western modernist sort of idea of how a painting should behave. But at the same time, I'm totally in love with modernism. And as an artist. So for me, I'm interested in a kind of idea of description and an idea of a kind of embodiment of perhaps narrative, all of the things that you know, we tend to be allergic to, and then coupled with a kind of awareness of the object, this kind of strange object with a painted event on one side of it. And so this is a painting of this sort of character that kind of physically stuck in this kind of rectangle, and it's kind of, you know, this kind of almost allegory of being stuck in a whale. That's how, like, everybody says. There's a lot of baggage, yeah. And it's called, the painting is called The Demands of Time, which I thought was a funny title. Okay, so this image is a,
I think if you just lean back but then project your voice, you won't. Yeah, there you go.
This is the first page of a book by Marianne Wex, who is the second wave feminist German photographer and artist. And it's called Let's Take Back Our Space, Men's and Women's Body Language as a Result of Patriarchal Structure. So it's a full name of the book. And it's basically this meticulous atlas that she created of these clandestine, candid photographs of the way that people sit, construct themselves, stand, talk to each other in public space, and how this kind of body language can be used as a kind of signifier to get at, you know, what, how these people want to sort of exist in their environment. And when I was introduced to this book by a friend, I was just kind of blown away by it, because that's exactly what I'm interested in as well, in terms of figurative painting and in terms of representational painting, is how these kinds of, you know, these kinds of gestures can become a kind of alphabet or a kind of vernacular that we're at once very familiar with when we encounter it, but then when you encounter a painted, handmade image of describing it, then it's like a kind of a primary experience as well. So it's like this kind of strange feeling of being familiar with something, but then seeing something for the first time. I kind of think about that as well quite a bit in my own work. So that's it, I guess.
Great. Thank you. This is an arresting image. Yeah, thanks for bringing it. Well, I'll have to write the title down later. So Charline von Heyl is next down the line, and we are lucky to have her back. She's been in Texas for a little bit and is here now working on a whole host of things. The next on the agenda, I think, is a solo show in Chicago at Corbett and Dempsey, and thereafter a group of drawings or collages will be seen here at the Whitney in the same biennial that opens in March. And in the meantime, there's a two-person exhibition with the German artist Vols that will be at the Rose Art Museum in Boston, which is yet another reason to go up to Boston soon. So thank you for your time, and thanks for coming, and let's see what you got.
Right. That's a painting that I just finished in Texas. It's in the studio, it's finished, but I don't know if I'm going to let it out of the studio. There's a situation that you're like, now I have to look at it and see if it works or if it doesn't work and what it actually means and why I have made it. And those are all considerations that happen sometimes. I needed to make it, and that we were talking about process and how you make your paintings. One of my incentives to start something is, what else can I do? What else could be a painting of mine? How can another painting look like that still is my painting and that still has to do with the possibilities and the aims that I want to convey without looking exactly the same as the last one? So I want it to be something different. And in that case, so I always start with something that I'm unfamiliar with, that can be a different color or a different form or a different inspiration. In that case, it was obviously the format, because it's 16 feet long. It's a really a mural size kind of thing, which I've never done before. And I have before always insisted on being in the realm of the frame as a physical mirroring plane that I can reach with the gestures, so that it's basically very classical compositions, all the paintings. And in that case, I started painting it and realized very, very fast the obvious thing that that the composition is going to fall apart in the middle if I don't get something that puts a grip on it. And So thinking about painting, which we all do as painters all the time, obviously, and thinking, always coming back to this kernel of stupidity where you cannot name, you know, like where you know about something, but you cannot name it. And it has something to do with language. It is actually the inability to name it that makes it so important. That you can create something that you can't name is the thing that's interesting. But at the same time, it's extremely irritating that you can't name it. And it is something that I found out happens also with language itself. And I've been always obsessed with it in language, that you get to a point where you find a moment in language where it conveys what it wants without that it follows the actual narrative of the words. And two things. First, what I did was I used sentences from this new author that I discovered that I'm completely obsessed with. And I had cut out all the collages that I had made that were actually going to the Whitney, and I had all those strips of paper. And I don't do that anyway. When I'm in the studio, I do, you know, there's no surface that I'm not going to attack somehow. I'm creating a kind of a surrounding where I'm comfortable in. And words actually have a lot to do with it. It's not something that appears in the paintings, but in the studio, there are always a lot of words, slogans, whatever, some weird stuff. And those long strips of paper were perfect for that. So I started to put the sentences that I liked most from that author that I'm into, put them onto those things, and I realized that this is the perfect way of building a skeleton that will hold that frame, that long horizontal, only then to realize that the words themselves you can't use. You know, like in the moment where you have words, they're going to be read, it's going to be about it. So I slowly exchanged all the words for something that had the feeling of word. You like that, just so that the whole thing looks as if it has something to say, but in the end it doesn't. It's just, it has a slightly futuristic manifesto feeling, but it doesn't hold it, it stays a painting. And on the other hand, that painting is very simple. It's a 1-2 thing. And my paintings usually are very complicated, the way they're layered and they go back and forward and they have little, moments where they come into focus and then they get out of focus and the background is the foreground. And there are all those things that usually makes the paintings mysterious and go to that place where I find you cannot name what you see anymore. In that case, it's super simple. It's bang a background and bang those things on the foreground. And I realized that I was doing a super classical way of putting those paper strips somewhere, trying it out, and then painting it, copying it, actually copying it onto the painting, which is something I never do either. So I don't know yet if this is going to work or not, but I know that it's going to be, that it made sense in what I was thinking about. And this is the book that influenced me in doing that and where the sentences all came from. And I'm really obsessed with the guy. Jason Schwartz. For obvious reasons, I do like. It sounds so pretentious, but it's just a fact. I like to get into Finnegan's Wake and just see three sentences and just the feeling of the way that you something's there, but it's almost there, but it's not quite, because it's the same feeling that I get from a certain kind of painting, and it's the same feeling that gives me satisfaction, that this unnameable weird spot that's so close to being something, but it's not really. And Gertrude Stein is the same thing, but they both work so much with the construction of the words and what the words actually look like. And Jason Schwartz, to me, is somebody who, it's also experimental, but he managed to create a new narrative so that you actually get the feeling for the whole narrative, ex- exchanged for something else. And you are completely fascinated by the words and by the theme, but it's still the same thing. It's lists and objects, and it gives a feeling. All this stuff is very much about a feeling of something without really delivering on a precise thing that you can repeat or name. And so that's kind of a bubble that I'm in at the moment, and that painting has something to do with it. And for that reason, I respect that painting. I don't know if I'm so interested in it as a painting from a painterly point of view, but I find also the more I'm getting older that, you know, like there are thousands of other reasons. And we were talking about process, and I realized that process is what makes us painters. It's not the painting. It's, you know, like we are painters because we want to paint. And it's fine if we have the paintings and it's good if they work and all that stuff, but in the end, it's we are, our identity is at that moment when we do something and something happens. And that was kind of actually a breakthrough moment that frees me again. I think as a painter, you have to do that over and over, that you free yourself from what you're doing, what you're going to have, and get to the point where the moment where you're at ease or inspired doing something, that's what it's about. And then that worked with that painting. But I still don't know if I'm letting it out of the studio or not.
This makes me want to go paint right now. So that was pretty inspiring. Yeah, wow. So David Salle is last and most certainly not least. And he's had an iconic practice for quite a while, which I'm sure most of us are familiar with, and also recently has had bodies of work that have been rediscovered. And in November, there was a very evocative show of a group of work that had never been shown before that was at Per Skarsgård Gallery here. Were they called shadow paintings?
Ghost
paintings, ghost. And it left us all with the realization that there's a whole lot that we don't know about what he's doing and what he has done, and this is extremely exciting. And right now, he's kind of in the golden zone of having a lot of work in the studio and no extremely pressing deadlines for them, and so just gets to experiment and play with different materials and put different things together in the way that only he does. And I was lucky enough to see that the other day, and whatever he does next, we should all mark our calendars and go check it out. So, David, thank you for coming.
Thanks a lot, Jordan.
Point it back at the thing.
You have to point it
out. Oh, really? Okay. Oh, that's that? Okay. Painting is about a year old. It's just too loud, right? Maybe 7 feet tall. It's interesting that so far there's been already a discussion or dialogue about binary-ness, keeping two or more things in one's mind simultaneously. Because I always felt like there was something wrong with me, that I always gravitated toward a space that was two spaces, or two spaces that became three, to an image that became, that required a secondary image, and so on and so on. Because so much at the core, at the heart of modern painting is making something that's kind of irreducible and ineluctable, the one thing, the narrowing down to the one key core experience. And I've just never been able to do it myself. So it always felt like a kind of deficit, but you have to work with the cards you've been dealt. You can't really will yourself into being this or that kind of a painter. I'm interested in the very notion of simultaneity, of what it means, how it feels, how to not to render it or reproduce it, but how to actually experience it, how to make something which is that experience of a literal indivisibility. And the paintings are made intuitively, through trial and error, there's not much system that dictates what goes with what, which is the most often asked question. How do you know what goes with what? And the answer is, I don't. But as similar to what Charline was saying, and very eloquently, one, if one's a painter, one knows it when one sees it or one feels it. So the way the painting, what the painting is a painting of, there's a this kind of portrait painted in oil and linen on the bottom half, and above, the image is built out of acrylic paint on a metal panel, on top of which is a silk screen of a photograph that I made of detritus on the beach. On top of that is a layer of finger painting, and on top of all of it, as sort of like the cherry in the sundae, is a ceramic vase that you're seeing the end of. You're seeing it project into space, as it were. It's very hard to read in photograph, but when you see it in real life, it has another surface and obviously a different space. So this, the top panel is, the image is something which you would normally see horizontally, which is now made vertical, so there's a spatial disorientation. And the vase is something you would normally see flat and is now sort of coming right at you. I don't know what any of it means, and I frankly don't much care. I'm interested in the visual experience of it and what that, the meaning of that experience. Coming up here tonight, I just happened, I mean, it could have been any piece of music in the 20th century or probably any other century, but I just happened to hear on the radio Mahler's Ninth Symphony was being played by the Berlin Philharmonic. And it's, I mean, it's one thing that painting doesn't have, which is a specific viewing time and the idea of temporal intervals. It's continuous and ongoing or not. But the point is the Mahler's Ninth is such an accumulation of diverse sonic textures and even different tempos, different musical ideas, motifs, are constantly changing, shifting, overlapping, canceling each other out. And it's obviously not just Mahler, it's, you know, you could name hundreds of people. This is so much a commonplace in other art forms, but somehow it's still, or maybe I'm flattering myself, but I was going to say it still feels like some kind of new territory in painting. How do you make something which is organized around some other principle than a grid or a central image or whatever you can think of? And what, how do, as a painter, how do you keep yourself open to whatever that other kind of organization might be? I'm interested, generally speaking, in such a generality, it's almost banal, but in construction and in pictorial construction. What is a pictorial idea? What is pictorialism? What does it mean to have something pictured or something kind of held before your eye in a painted set of a system of painted marks? I think about all the time about what would, as everyone has spoken here, what would extend those ideas into something that makes me uncomfortable, that I'm not quite sure how to handle, and so forth. But the idea of how to organize things, diverse things, things that exist in counterpoint, how to lead one thing into another, in a way, if I were a dramatist instead of a painter, I would be concerned with entrances and exits of characters. I mean, how do you get people on and off stage? So the second image is this. My friend Amy Silman emailed me this image just about a week ago or 10 days ago. And I instantly knew when I saw it that it was the codex of just about everything that I'm concerned with. It's kind of an accidental Rosetta Stone. It's a picture about how to organize things in a pictorial space, how to do it without appearing to do it at all, how to do it without exerting any pressure, without exerting any intentionality. I've always said I think intentionality in art is wildly overrated, and I don't care about it at all. I don't want to hear about anyone's intentionality. I want things that feel like they are the product of a human endeavor, but that's different from intentionality. There used to be on Canal Street many, many years ago, I don't know if they're still there or not, something tells me they're not, stores that sold stuff, all manner of stuff, plastic things, metal things, ball bearings, cheap electronics, raincoats, toys, dog leashes, the random stuff made by factories to be sold cheaply and to be dispersed in the most immediate kind of way. And the stores that sold these things would set up plywood tables on the sidewalk in front of the storefronts, on which usually wooden bins would be arranged, or actually arranged is makes it sound much too deliberate, would just be placed, and these bins would be full of whatever they happened to be full of. This thing would be next to that thing, next to that thing, next to that thing, next to the color. One bin would be pink toothbrushes, and the next bin would be hats, and the next bin would be some more sophisticated optical electronical equipment. Probably some of it fell off a truck, some of it was, it doesn't matter where it came from. It all had the appearance of having just fallen from the sky. And the sort of standing joke in the art world for many years, this is all through the 70s, into the 80s, was, can you make anything that's as good as Canal Street? Just that, the seemingly random juxtapositions that were as poetic as anything in Ezra Pound, that kind of illuminating flash of consciousness that allows you to see the nature of something and how the organizing principle behind it was not the one you thought the one it was, and how does one get to that point of organizing things in that way, but without, again, without exerting too heavy a hand on it, without, so to speak, you want to hold the butterfly in your hand without tearing its wings off. And this happened as a daily occurrence for years, decades, maybe it still goes on. And I know that got into the art culture on a deep level, and maybe it's just now percolating to the surface. Thank you.
Thank you. Will you forward it one slide just so that we have a black, maybe one more. There we go. Yeah. So we don't have any visual noise. Thank you. Wow. Okay. What I'm hoping now is that we can kind of shift gears into a segment where we can just sort of maybe respond to some of the things that we've heard and add things that have come up that we wish we had said or something like that, and that we can kind of foster a conversation between and amongst the artists on the panel. But I will take the lead and kind of kick it off a little bit, because there was an idea about process that I think everybody was speaking to, and an idea about, apropos of your story about Canal Street, about how the world kind of bleeds into the studio, and simultaneously this idea about not knowing what you're doing or going to a place where you're not exactly sure, or that, as Charline was saying, maybe there's not a word for, but you know it's poetic or something like this. And all of these seem to me to be aspects of how a work starts. not knowing exactly where you're going. Maybe there's a preconceived idea. Maybe something came in from afar. And also, speaking to your idea of process, you said that you don't know what did you say? I wrote it down. Not knowing what you're doing, but knowing what you're making.
Knowing what I'm doing, but
not knowing what you're making. Exactly. And so my question would just be about that, about if you feel that you would have something to say without a recourse to intentionality and giving us a guide to interpreting your work, but just talk about how a painting starts or how something about your process that we might not know or that you've been thinking about that you would be willing to talk to each other about or that you might say.
I've been thinking about how we really look at images now a lot, and that has to do everything to do with screens. And the interesting thing is that the screen is the thing, and the images just come and go, and but painting has to be fixed in some way. So how do you reflect that in painting? And I think it's a very, very difficult question. I mean, I'm not saying all painters need to think about this, but what image would you commit to a painting when images are so kind of come and go, and the thing seems to be the screen itself in a way that we rely on. We just love to look at this thing, this lit thing, And it's just something that I'm puzzling with, and it's I think it would be something you'd call, normally or in past days we call it a crisis for painting. In a sense, it is, but it's if you think it just folds into the general sort of experience of everyday crisis, which is I think also the way we live now, that we just live in sort of permanent state of crisis, and worse, actually. So it's so interesting that I think that everybody's work here in one way or another kind of addresses that in a way. There's a sort of this, not so much an ambiguity, it's a sort of fluidity of reading that as Salle and Sanya's drawing, as Tip's work is to the sort of very itinerant quality of Charline's work and everything in between, seems to kind of deal with that in some way. This kind of it's not exactly a non-committalness. I mean, certainly Charline is really, and Tip are really making images, also David, all of you, really making images in a sense, but it's, always with the sense of that it could easily just be another or different image. Does that strike anybody as relevant?
Yeah, it's super interesting. I'm not sure what to say about it. You're talking about how to translate the flow of experience into one fixed thing, which is sort of one of the basic painting problems.
How to hold attention.
Sure, yeah.
But it's
but
possible.
With an image.
It's possible. I mean, that's the beauty of it.
Yeah.
It's possible. Mm-hmm. And it's the more one, it has been possible and it will be possible and it is possible. And that's why painting is so alive always, I think.
But I guess what I'm wondering is it the image itself, or is it the way that it's painted, or is one able to sort of separate those things?
Go ahead.
Well, it's such a wonderful question because we don't know what it is, but I do think when we don't know what it is in advance, I do think once it exists, you probably can actually decode why something works, why when it works, it does work. What's amazing about a painting is that it can really just be a line on a canvas. We've been talking about it in terms of Ivan anyway, but about an additive kind of play. It doesn't have to be. It can be the most reductivist thing of all, and yet that thing expands to fill consciousness when you look at it. That's the most mysterious thing. How does it do that? By what mechanism? Because not any mark on any surface would do that, only a very specific mark on a specific surface. What is the specific pressure that results in the one which works? I'm repeating myself. I do think it can be decoded if you're looking at something, but it's hard to know.
After the fact, you mean?
Yeah, only after the fact, right. I don't know, what do you think? Do you think it's, you don't really know?
I think that this kind of je ne sais quoi thing that we all want in a painting, when we can't understand exactly what we're looking at, we can't figure it out, for me, it can be both. It can be an image, but it's such an incredibly strange image that you can't wrap your head around it and you forget about the painting. Or it can actually be a painting where you cannot forensically reconstruct or even begin to think about the decision-making that went into the painting that is in front of you. And I think that both of those things are really interesting. And that's why, for me, like, for example, like the distinction between an abstract painting or a figurative painting is not so important, because I can be equally kind of seduced and stumped and kind of sent for a spin by either. Like, there's socialist realist painting that I cannot figure out. I don't understand how this person arrived at an image that was so incredibly strange. And vice versa with Charlene's paintings or with your paintings, where I'm just standing there trying to put myself in the shoes of the person who made this object. So I think they're both quite important in the end.
I find it interesting also to think about, we as painters are used to talk among us about paintings. So we really are connoisseurs, and then we look a lot, you know, like we have educated ourselves, our lives basically is now, our eyes are the one organ that's kind of freakishly
overdeveloped.
Exactly. And the conversation that we have has a lot to do with this looking, and not necessarily, but it does. But that there is actually that point that it actually translates, you know, that even people that don't look all the time, that are not that, you know, like a painting can have that quality, that it actually, speaks on its own terms to somebody who does not know the language. Mm. And that is, I guess, something that we...
Right, the contentious world around painting is usually focused on the assumption that the meaning is a matter of context. It's the social construct of paintings in a place where people go to look at paintings is the thing that gives the meaning. Well, you know, everyone knows the argument that it's not, it's just this kind of a cultural agreement. But any painter can tell you that's not really true. Things have meaning in this, even though it's, you know, people will fight you tooth and nail on this point, things have meaning in their own autonomous way. And that's, I think, that's sort of what you say if you're a painter. You throw down the gauntlet to say exactly that. This thing is actually autonomous. It also has cultural reference points and points of cultural intersection in a myriad ways, but that's not what makes it interesting.
Well, which change over time, too, as the context changes.
Of course, it changes. Yeah.
To reconnect in different ways.
Yeah. I do also think that's what a painting should strive for, is that kind of moment where it's more democratic. I think there's also, I think there's actually a lot of painting and other stuff that's made and lives only with a given education or a given code, and some people have written about the fact that in the end that kind of becomes a class signifier, like Bourdieu distinctions or something like that. And so that's actually something I think about quite a bit, of this idea of this kind of pedestrian, plebeian kind of democracy in painting versus painting that is like, you know, made for this kind of uber connoisseur who understands how to decode it. So I think that's another issue.
But does it bother you that it's not very democratic, or you think it should
be?
Well,
I try to sort of think about that and be aware of, and I mean, that's such a weirdly itchy topic, you know, because it's a paradox, because the harder something is to understand, kind of the stronger it is as well, in a certain sense. So it's a complicated kind of tension, for me at least, as a painter, of how to make something that speaks in a certain way on a broader level, but is also kind of hard to understand on a much narrower level. I don't know if that makes any sense, but
I think I don't know if I have a different point. I'm not sure what, if there's a consensus. There doesn't seem to be any consensus about it. I'm not really sure what we're talking about, but the I know as I've gone further down the road of my own work that I I'm very aware that I'm the first viewer. Like, I'm the person who has to be in a relationship with this stuff and care about it and, you know, on a good day, believe in it. On a bad day, think it's horrible. But it's all about a feedback loop with myself. That's where the work happens. And then when it leaves my immediate surroundings and one is fortunate enough to have other people look at it and respond to it, in a way, it's out of your control. Like, so it, in that sense, it's an autonomous object because I can't control what people think about it once it leaves me. But, and I also can't unlock, you know, I'm thinking, I suppose that's part of what this post office mural thing is about. I'm thinking a lot about this idea of like, who exactly would be the audience for this stuff? Like, okay, I'm interested. And I know there's an art world, which, you know, presumably cares about all this stuff. But like, would a person that just walked into a room and saw one of my paintings, you know, get anything out of it at all? For some reason, that thought has been with me a lot. And I can't unlearn what I know, you know? Like, I joined the art team when I was like 20 years old, and I can't unlearn all the things I know. So I suppose by this point, you could say I'm making paintings for an elite viewership. But I don't really think like that. You know, like I don't think about it when I'm working. I just think about whatever random stuff goes through my head and the fact that I need to be interested in the thing before anyone else gets a chance to have an opinion.
Yeah, that's what I meant with that the process is actually what makes us as painters. So, I mean, that's oversimplified, obviously, but.
While you're talking, can I ask you a question about one thing that you said, which just was about challenging the own truths of your work? I think this was something that maybe you said that I wrote down. Challenge the most basic truths about your own work. I think that's something also that anybody who's trying to move their practice forward uses as a device. And I wonder if you could talk about how you do that in the studio and if anybody else wants to chime in. I think it's interesting to think about how to both stake out posts of the pasture that you want to graze in, but also to kind of move the posts around. And if that's something that you could discuss, I think I would love to hear.
Well, I've just gotten so sick of my own pronouncements. You know, like I've always been big with the pronouncements, and I when I was young, I defined what I was doing in a certain way, and I knew what's good, I knew what's bad, and as I move along, I just think a lot of that stuff is irrelevant. You know, like you do what you do, and trying to define it or give it some sort of, you know, create a program that you could explain to someone else, like this is what my work is about and all of that, it just seems so lame to me now. And, you know, I've always said like that I'm not interested in, the reason I mentioned this in my little presentation was because I've always taken the position, particularly as my work has become more and more filled with nameable subjects, that narrative isn't an interest of mine. I'm not trying to tell stories. They don't come about like that. That's not the way to look at them. But then I turn around and I'm getting super interested in these things that are completely driven by narrative, and it makes me realize, you know, how specious my own pronouncements to myself are. So I think that's the process. I think you just go through that over and over and over again. My taste has changed, grown, shrunk, done all different weird flips. A lot of things interest me now that I used to think were crap, and vice versa. And I just think that's life, you know?
I love this idea of the first viewer that you brought up, because it points also to something like that Charline was saying about what we do as painters, which is we make things. But I think that there's this kind of schizophrenic aspect of like, when you're making, you're not looking, and when you're looking, you're not making. But you're making so you have something to look at. And I think part of that is that we get bored. We get really bored. And you know, this is a very human thing. But I think this assumption of like a first viewer, it's a very kind of leveling idea. You know, it's, you're not authoring something, you're just looking at it as anyone would, or trying to, you know, put yourself in anyone's shoes, or just in your very own shoes as a human being, and, you know, almost as a kind of a moment of prophecy of its, of other times it will be looked at, and, yeah. And, but, you know, but then that maker comes in, like, again, we'll just, like, I've just ruined a lot of paintings, surely out of boredom, because I wanted to, them to go a different direction or something, and you know, that's how one evolves one's own work, and also from, like, sort of the received language when one enters, you know, the craft or whatever, you sort of want to mess up or, you know, change things that you received as just out of, you know, wanting to see something new or different.
Yeah, I think, but there's a lot of things very interesting. I mean, one is that the artist could be the last to know. You could be the last to know about your own work. You could be telling yourself something about
that's it. That's for sure.
For decades, it's just not true, whatever true is. But it's also going back to this thing about intentionality. I mean, thank you, Jacqueline. That's very beautifully put. I make something that weirdly enough, as it might seem, I make what I actually want to look at. And it's, I kind of want to see what that's going to look like, that thing. So the imputing to all that, all this intentionality and social blah, blah, I'm not saying it's not there, but it's not paramount in my mind. It's, again, weird as it might seem, I'm trying to make something which I think is beautiful. What does beautiful mean? Well, I don't know, but boredom is, or the avoidance of boredom definitely plays a part in what I find beautiful. So the idea, I guess what I'm trying to say in simplest terms is, I don't think a painting is just a accumulation of cultural signs, and I think that's sometimes how it's seen. It's not to say it doesn't have cultural signs, but that's it seems a shame to limit it to that. And I don't know whether it's democratic or elitist or anti-democratic. Frankly, I just don't think those terms mean very much to me. Like the aesthetic criteria, those terms have a way of trading places periodically as well. I don't think the experience is closed off. The experience of looking at a painting is closed off to anyone who wants to take time to look at it. So it's democratic in principle. In practice, I have no idea. I'm not sure I care.
Okay. Well, I want to leave time to open the floor up to the audience, but maybe we could I could just ask one question before we do that, because this idea of boredom came up, and it's something that I can also relate to. And I'm wondering if anybody has anything else that they want to add about boredom, and how to avoid boredom, or how to embrace boredom, or how to reckon with boredom, because part of painting is a material encounter that happens over time, and it usually takes a longer time to see the thing that you're trying to see, to make the thing that you're trying to see, than you want. And is there a way that you all approach boredom and the sometimes distended time frame that it takes to make something that you would want to talk about?
Just super comfortable with boredom.
And that's something I have a 10-year-old, and I try to teach him that. Like, you hear that a lot. Like, I'm bored, you know, and you know, the moment you take away the iPhone or whatever, they're bored, and you know, it's I realize how deprived he is not to have enough boredom with all these entertaining things around, because that's when you sort of become resourceful and you get interested. You know, and it's been said also, boredom, there's no such thing as boredom, it's anger, you know, it's like, it's disguised anger. I'm not sure I understand that, but, you know, what is boredom? It's just a space between things that you fill in somehow.
But I would even go so far to say that the boredom that we have as artists is kind of, if you could boil down, you know, like a kind of a critique from outside, that it's in that boredom, it's the ultimate freedom. You know, like, that's the luxury that we have, is that we can afford that boredom to us. It's not the boredom of somebody who has to work, who's, you know, like sits in some stupid shop and nobody comes in for 8 hours and they see their lives go away. It's, you know, like a self-chosen boredom that that we cherish, I think, all of us, secretly. You know, like those hours where we're actually staring at the walls. You know, like if I will look back at my life, that's going to be the time that I thought was worth living for.
But it is a weird thing to spend your life like facing a wall. It's a very strange thing to do.
Well, you know,
you said it very well. You said painters have a highly developed, you know, ocular capability. It's just, we're just eyes, and other people are just ears. I mean, it's highly limiting. It's highly limited, but it's okay. I love looking at things. Could be the wall.
Well, also, I mean, my own interest in painting is, you know, I don't feel like it's anything I would want to generalize about, but it definitely has to do with the idea of making things with one's hands. That's not the way everyone thinks about painting. You know, I've avoided, not out of a conscious choice, it just seems to be what I've done. My work doesn't deal with photographic techniques, it doesn't deal with, I mean, I've done a lot of printmaking, but within my painting, I don't do anything that doesn't make it time-consuming and kind of weird by most people's standards of how they spend the day. You know, I draw on little pieces of paper, I make something, I look at it, I go for a walk, I eat something, I go back, I schmooch around some more. You know, it's like not everyone would like to spend their day like that. But
actually, a lot of people would like.
Yeah.
To.
So no, but it's not. It's almost understimulating. You know, like it's a choice I've made to have an understimulating day-to-day routine.
Yeah, I mean,
and out of that comes these things that I find fascinating to think about.
I mean, I feel like we shouldn't demystify it completely too much.
Sorry. The cat's out of the bag now.
But we do have Pontormo's diary, which, for example, if you read Pontormo's diary, Tuesday, painted half of a hand, had a hard-boiled egg, glass of wine. Wednesday, painted the other half of hand, ate a hard-boiled egg, glass of wine. In the evening, Il Rosso came to my door. I don't know what he wanted.
Great.
He was bored.
And had a perfect life. So I think maybe we have 15 minutes or 20 minutes when we can open it up to questions, if you have any questions. And is there a microphone going around? Okay.
Speak into it.
Speak into the microphone, because so how are we going to choose here? Do you want to run this? Here we go. Jen is in charge. There you go.
I seem to sense a lot of duality in the paintings and works that we saw. It's neither this nor that, or maybe it's this and that. And I was wondering if that's intentional or whether that came about through the process of what you were doing, or whether I'm mistaken in what I see.
what was the beginning of the question?
A sense of duality.
Duality.
A sense of duality. More yeah. Obvious in David's paintings. But I sense it in your paintings too. There's a,
right.
There's a one textural, one very linear, and one very diffuse. And in almost all of the works that I saw, I had this sense that there was a duality there, though it expressed itself in different ways. And I just don't know whether that's intentional, whether it came about through the process. What is it really all about?
So duality, what's up with that?
It's a really important point, and then I don't think it's a coincidence that that this comes up so much. I think that making art nowadays, the way it, you can work, is to take extremes and to try to get them together. You like to fuse something that hasn't been fused before, or to get attention by having something that wants to pull apart, or there's a certain aggression in insisting on the duality, or which can also be more than two things, but it's just, I think we all do that. It's basically, I hate that word, but it's basically a postmodern approach that by now actually has become something that we all are raised on, and that has become the most interesting thing to do, to find again and again something that you force into a hole that seemed to be impossible to do.
That's great. Next.
It's coming to the next question.
Walk over there.
Okay, here we are.
I saw a really interesting relationship between this panel and there was a panel on painting a couple weeks ago at the Guggenheim. And Richard Prince was asked a question by Roberta Coitman or something, and the answer was like, I don't care about issues of gender, or not really, but the idea of this position of I don't care about class or about the democratic versus the non-democratic issues of viewing, it seems like very much of a generational posture. And I was interested in the way like Sanya brought that up in relation to David Salle. And I was just wondering what your response to that would be.
Well, I don't think it's generational. I think that whatever one wants to name those impulses, they've all been around for a very long time, and they're all still around, and they're not going away. Nothing that ever was actually comes to an end in art. So there are always people who want art to be for the people, and then there are other people who don't particularly care. I don't think it's generational, but maybe you do.
Yeah, I mean, I don't, I also feel like really awkward that I opened that can of worms, because these are clearly really painters, and we're talking about painting. And I don't think about it when I'm working. I think about my painting when I'm working and what's in front of me. But I do think about the kind of world outside of the things that I make. And I don't know if, I don't think it's a generational thing. I think it's more of a, I think some people, I think it's different types of, kind of, it's different kinds of thinking, I think. For me, I think about certain things because of where I'm from that, say, David does not think about or doesn't care about as much, and I'm sure that David cares about certain things that I care about less, etc. I think there's people, I think in general, thinking about something other than art is very out of vogue in a way, especially when it comes to making things with your hands, because as soon as you start talking about something, it can become literal very easily, and I think when things are literal or when there's a narrative, it becomes a very dangerous territory, and I think probably that's one of the reasons why Carroll strays away from the idea of narrative or the idea of telling a story, because those two, painting and telling a story in the contemporary art context, are things that don't really go together, and I think it's very scary to go there in general.
Yeah. I think it's really a good answer. I also would add to the person who asked the question, on this notion of literalism, that one shouldn't take something an artist says necessarily so literally. Just because Richard said in that moment, I don't care about these things, it doesn't mean he doesn't care. It just means he doesn't want to say that he cares.
Well said.
Great.
And if he said that he cared, he'd be really not saying that he didn't care. Yeah.
It's Zeno's paradox.
I think caring is very out of fashion right now.
Really?
caring
is never out of fashion.
Caring about what you're caring. Well, I think we care.
Yeah, I just idea that I had in my head for a couple of days or more, at least, but, which is that, you know, if this is a very non-narrative time, let's say, I've just been thinking about the fact that humans by nature, and probably primates and maybe even insects, all are living, conceived in narrative terms. Even the most, pardon it, this is a prejudice, shall we say, or whatever, but I mean, even someone who is like really autistic, let's say, or someone who is very non-emotional, there's narrative in everyone. I mean, it's part of our substance. We can't really get away from it. And the other idea, which is like been a very, like for many years, been very focused for me, culturally. And I was away from New York for a while, but anyway, I just came back, and I forget about whatever I think about New York, but one of the things is that I've been stuck for a long time just because of like me in relationship to my parents' generation, is like how incredible this New York was, or this culture, or this civilization, or I'm getting a little carried away, but I did on the eve of the Second World War. And that was a time of great narrative and great intentionality and great meaning, and who would ever think of using the word boredom in that time? So I'm just, these are all just reflections that have been going on in my head relative to
Can I just jump in for a second and say that I think that maybe something to answer your question about narrative, I think that the idea of an innate primate way of telling stories is narrative is not exactly the same thing as the kind of narrative maybe that Tip was talking about, not wanting read into his work. So I think that all paintings probably have narrative. I think the way that even I can communicate to you through a string of words that are coming out of my mouth is narrative. But I think what we were maybe trying to get at, and I don't want to put words in your mouth, but has to do with not reading the work as a storytelling illustration of something that can be easily decoded.
Right, I got that. But I'm just wondering, why is there that impulse so strongly now, say, as opposed
Well, I think yeah. that... I think you're not wrong about the human impulse to project stories onto reality. I mean, that's part of making sense out of reality. And cultures have narratives that they cling to. For example, the United States of America's picture of itself and its role in the world, which is quite different from the way it's perceived from outside. This time you're talking about near the Second World War, that was a point of like, very clear collective narrative, and there's probably a lot of wishful thinking on the part of many artists. It's like, gee, it would have been so interesting to be alive then. A smaller art world, a clearer story, art history appeared to follow a vector. You know, I started going to the Museum of Modern Art in the early 70s, and the collection was laid out like a narrative. But I don't think that accounts for the reality we're living in now. And I don't think that there is a shared narrative. And I also don't think that if you really get down to it, that these people, all of us, or the whole world of artists, even agree about what art is for. So it goes so much back to the personal for me, just over and over, it just keeps cycling back, I always think about all the, the deep stuff everybody thinks about, whatever, I read the paper. But, the reality is I'm alone with my work. The narrative that I have in my head is the narrative that I, the story I tell myself about my own life. And my paintings aren't, it's exactly what Jordan said, my paintings don't illustrate anything. They're objects that come about in this life that I'm living. And beyond that, I don't even really know what to say about them. But I think you have to. I think you have to expand your idea of narrative to the collective.
Yeah, and probably that time that we were romanticizing about, in fact, was much less monolithic.
No doubt.
Than as all times are, But I think the point we've been collectively trying to make that is that the for the work to have any validity, personal validity, it can't just be subsumed into some literal narrative. Now, that doesn't mean, beat everyone else, that the of course painting is a big drama. It's a big drama, but it's a drama on its own terms. When the drama can be subsumed into other kind of cultural terms, it's something else. And I think that it's hard for painters to come to terms with that, because who wouldn't want to tell stories that everybody could love, whatever those stories might be? We're just kind of not in that business, you know. But that doesn't mean it's not. But, you know, there are a lot of people who do that. It's such a high level of satisfaction. It would be absurd for me to compete with them. That's just how I feel about it.
I think it's often said that, you know, art has no, is useless, but I actually disagree with that. And I think like that, what you're talking about, this narrative of the Second World War and how art was used, sort of, implicated in that narrative. Something that maybe had very little to do with the artists. And, because this thing of intentionality certainly exists. In order to create an action, you have to intend something, but it's not meaning per se. Again, it's to make something. And the way these different ways that art is used is a kind of flattening and a diminishing of it in a sense too. And in the 80s, for instance, the New York School was very, sort of a bad thing, and it had a lot to do with the way that they were used in these narratives and instrumentalized, so to speak. And I think it just made the paintings more invisible, less accessible, ultimately. And so there are dangers to that. I think artists are very wary of those kinds of things that happen around their work. Almost try to set up resistances to it, so to speak, from within.
Great. Well, maybe we could have two more questions, just to respect everybody's time. So, yes.
So I was really interested in how everybody kind of has this idea when they start the painting, almost everybody on the panel, that there's a series of ambivalences that generally get channeled into like a structure of ambiguities about what you're doing. But no one's really addressed the point of resolution. And I know Alice Neal famously said when asked when she was how did she know when she was finished? And she said, when I stopped working on it. And I always think that's a pretty good thing. But I'd like to sort of know what your kind of ontological feeling is of the point of resolution when you actually don't work on it anymore, when you've stopped.
What's the feeling of stopping?
it's
unanswerable.
This old art school thing that, you go into a space and you say it works. It doesn't work. It works. It's the same thing. When I stop working on it, you have to look for at it for time, or you don't. Sometimes you know it immediately. That really is intuition, and it's like, that's such a stupid thing to say, but it's really, that's what we made ourselves into, the people who decide when it is done. And obviously, sometimes we decide that it's exactly done when it's totally undone. but that's where, that's also where the whole thing about boredom and all that stops totally. Because that moment when it's done and you think it's good, no matter what it is, it doesn't matter. But that moment is actually super intense. And all the thing about boredom is paid for by that moment when it's actually there.
Something happens. I don't know. When something's finished, something happens, and it's like there's somebody. For a little while, I feel like there's somebody else in the room with me or something. It's like the thing develops a kind of spirit that it didn't have, that I know is potentially there. But beyond that, it's a nice feeling to finish something, but it doesn't last very long. You know, it's like
it's a short high.
Yeah. No, it's.